It's my privilege. Dylan has been serving the Lord with us for the last couple of years. He and Alicia, we really didn't have a part in it, but I think we did. Okay, they got married on January 1st. Okay. And I don't know if he had been in a different group, you know, who knows? If you guys had interned at some other place, I think God's hand was in putting you two together and with us all together here, right? Don't you think? Amen. Yeah, of course. That's why I said us. But Dylan loves the Lord. And what's really cool is that his testimony is a background that comes from an experience of not having known God. And here's what's really amazing is, are you going to share this?
No.
Oh, good. Don't want to steal your thunder. What's really amazing is how God used, I was going to call it wrong, not heavy metal.
Hardcore music
to lead him to Jesus. Amazing. What God can do when God calls us to Him. And our youth, and we have been privileged to have Dylan and Alicia ministering with us for the last couple years. And so it's my privilege to welcome and invite to our pulpit today Dylan Bouquet.
That's a tall joke. I was going to introduce myself this morning because some of you know me, some of you don't. I also want to apologize real fast, quick disclosure. Bill's very charismatic, a little bit on the spunky side. I'm not so much on the spunky side. I do want to share a few fun facts about myself, since Bill already shared a little bit of my testimony. That way we can kind of get to know each other a little bit. I'm a Kings fan, an LA Kings fan. I love hockey. Something about the violence gets me. I do love hardcore music. It's a very aggressive style of music where people go to these tiny little music venues, and we get together to listen to these bands and hit each other. It's weird, but yeah. Another little fact is I'm very terrified of the ocean. It started with the fear of whales, and then it just kind of, which was weird, but then it just kind of became about the ocean itself. I have a story that kind of goes along with describing my fear of the ocean. Last year, about New Year's, me and Alicia and Carmina and a couple other friends from Caneo, we went to San Diego to celebrate the New Year. Someone, I don't remember who it was, decided, let's go kayaking in San Diego on top of the ocean, where it's not where I wanted to be. So everyone's like, yeah. I'm like, no, please. So we're kayaking. Alicia and I are in one kayak. And at this point, we are just dating. And I am effectively, I like to say effectively, it turned out that way, courting her. So we're kayaking on the ocean. The tour guide at one point says, okay, guys, you can all stand up on your kayaks. You can jump off into the ocean if you'd like. And Alicia is a little bit more adventurous than I am, and she turns around and says, if you do it, I'll do it. And so I puff out my chest and say, yeah. Of course I'll do that. And I'm thinking, please, God. Please, God, I'm praying right now. Please, don't let her jump into the ocean. We stand up. She just gracefully just swan dives into the water. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. This is it. God, please, Jesus, come back. And so I somehow managed to stumble out of the kayak into the water. And as soon as I'm in the water, I immediately feel the depth. It's unlike anything I've ever felt in my life, because we're out there. We're not, you know, we're not in like a little shallow area. So I immediately feel the depth, and the panic just sets in, and the fear in me summons this merman suddenly with this amazing display of beauty and human strength, which I don't have a lot of. I kick with my legs underwater. And you remember Free Willy? I come out of the water, and I land on the kayak. One motion. And I brush off my humiliation like it never happened. Because I'm good. I'm safe. But Alicia's still in the water, kicking around. And I turn to her, and I say, "Babe, I'm so sorry I kicked you." To which she replied, "You didn't kick me." Yeah, that's why the ocean scares me. We'll leave it there. Good morning. A little bit about me. So this morning we are we're talking about prayer. We're talking about this kind of constant struggle between an old self and a new self. And we're talking about a choice. Last week, you guys went over the first part of Gethsemane last week, right, Bill?
Yes.
Sweet. Last week, you guys went over the choice, the choice that Jesus made in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus made a choice to submit to God. In the midst of such a great trial, such great sorrow, amidst a struggle, he chose God. And as we continue in the story, we see that Jesus had asked the disciples to pray with him. So Mark 14, verse 37, we pick up where Jesus had left off after asking the disciples to pray. Verse 37, "And he came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, 'Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour?'" And I want to stop at this first verse for just a quick second. One, he's calling Peter Simon in regards to Peter being asleep. Peter, before last week, I'm sure you guys went over this, this is before the Gethsemane. But Peter had told Jesus, after Jesus warned that they would all fall away, Peter said, they will all fall away, but I will not. And so here Peter is, tired and asleep. So Jesus approaches him and says, "Simon." That's like the ultimate, "I'm not mad, I'm just disappointed." When he calls you by your old name, I wouldn't want to be in that position. He says, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch for 1 hour?" I don't think that when Jesus approached the disciples and asked them to pray, I don't think they got together in a little corner when Jesus wasn't looking and said, "All right, guys, we're gonna disobey God right now. We're gonna go to sleep." Because that'd be weird. But it also doesn't say it in Scripture. The disciples had just celebrated Passover with Jesus. Jesus is kind of laying on them some pretty heavy news. It's very late at night, so we see that they are physically drained. We can imagine they're pretty emotionally drained. That starts to leave us vulnerable. Do you guys ever realize that maybe you're not quite your best when you're physically and emotionally exhausted? Maybe we say things we don't mean to say to other people, or we have an attitude, or we just kind of let things slip by. In the disciples' case, they fall asleep. because they're tired. It's not the gravest of sins. But Jesus goes on to say in verse 38, "Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, they just fell asleep, which to some people, that doesn't seem like that big of a deal. What's the temptation that Jesus is talking about? You see, like I said, when they entered the Garden of Gethsemane, there were two choices that were made. There was a choice that Jesus made, and there was a choice that disciples made. Jesus chose God, and the disciples chose themselves. They chose their flesh. Jesus asked them to pray. He invited them to make the same choice, to choose God, to be with him in a very critical moment in his life. I also think in this setting, there's probably a level of comfort and familiarity that I think a lot of us can maybe identify with. I can certainly identify with this idea of they've been with Jesus now for 3 years. He's not just their teacher, but he's their friend. They're in a pretty safe place for the time being. So he tells them, "Hey guys, come pray with me." I'm sure they probably thought, Yeah, that's fine. I'll pray after I catch a little 5-minute nap. We get in these points where we kind of think we know what's going on. We know what to expect from God. We know what to expect from Jesus. We've been kind of doing this dance for a while, and we get comfortable. So we have comfort. We have exhaustion. We have emotional toll that they've no doubt experienced. And they chose themselves. And it's not just in this moment. The temptation that Jesus is talking about is also yet to come. In fact, it never really stops. If we look at our walk, when I look at my walk with Jesus, I'm ashamed to say how many times I've chose myself over God. It's not always a direct act of disobedience. But yeah, I get tired. I get emotionally drained. And what that all kind of leads up to, and what I feel the disciples felt and experienced, was this act of not just falling asleep physically, but falling asleep spiritually. We kind of stop putting up that fight. And that's where Jesus leads into. He talks about, he says, "The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." What Jesus is talking about here is a battle. Peter told Jesus that he would be with him even if everyone else left. He wanted to be there. Again, I'm certain Peter did not write down in an agenda book, when Jesus asked me to pray, I'm going to go to sleep. But it's a constant battle. In fact, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul talks about this battle. Verse 17, Paul writes, "For the desires of the flesh are against the spirit, and the desires of the spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things that you want to do." That doesn't just sound like a battle, that sounds almost like a hostile battle. That sounds like our flesh is doing whatever it can to fight, to keep us from doing the things that we want to do. Peter wanted to be there. but he was tired. He was asleep, spiritually and physically. I love this passage. This half of the passage. Really, this whole experience that we go through in the Garden of Gethsemane, because, I don't know, my life verses, my favorite passages, they usually reflect how much we almost always blow it, but how awesome God is. This particular passage is convicting for me in more than one way, but I find myself often tired and even spiritually asleep. This morning, I feel, is a perfect example. I've never really done this before. I talk to you guys during Thanksgiving, and I talk to our youth every Wednesday, but I've never sat down and prepared a sermon before, and oh my gosh, that was most, I don't know what I'll say next time, Bill, when you ask me. Thank you. That was very, very difficult. But it all led to, I mean, really, all the preparation, everything that I could have done, all the prayer led to this morning. This morning was a very key moment for me. This morning, I told myself, I'm going to wake up early, especially early. I'm going to sit down with coffee. I'm going to pray. I'm going to open up the Word. I'm going to start this out right. I hit snooze like 5 times. I woke up a little bit later than I expected. Skip the coffee. But the worst part was that I skipped the prayer. Not only was I physically tired, I was exhausted. I'm not a morning person. But I was very much spiritually asleep this morning. That led to this battle of my flesh, this battle of maybe falling into some old habits. Unfortunately, this morning that battle was won by my old self. I'm trying to do my hair. I never look like this, by the way. I usually have a flannel on. I usually have a hat on. Most people don't know I have hair. I do. I'm doing my hair and I'm putting on my shirt. And my wife is noticing that I'm a little bit frantic. She's noticing that my hair just won't do the stupid thing I wanted to do. And she's trying to get me to calm down, and she's trying to get me to look at her so that I could just kind of take it easy for a second, recollect myself. And I snapped. I don't remember exactly what I said, but I basically told her, no, I will not look at you right now. And I just think, what would have happened if I prayed? What would have happened if the disciples prayed with Jesus? Let me find out where I am in my notes. Yes, back to Scripture. Verse 39, and again he, Jesus, went away and prayed, saying the same words. So Jesus is repeating his prayer from earlier. Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. And he's repeating this prayer over and over. It's important. He's trying to demonstrate how important this is. And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. They're in a spiritual coma at this point. Jesus continues to go back to them. They're continuing to fall asleep. I think about how many times I continue to try to fight. I continue to try to turn my behavior around. I continue to try to act with my best ability, with my new self, putting that best foot forward. But Jesus keeps coming back to me and saying, "You're still asleep." And you notice they're still not praying. He came to them a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest?" So we kind of see that Jesus isn't—he's not mad. He's not braiding a whip. He understands. It's no excuse, but he understands. He just says, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners." It's remarkable. We're so undeserving, but he is so awesome to continue to call us to walk with him. We let him down. We turned our backs on him not just once, but three times. In a very critical moment. In the moment that defined what the cross is. We turned our backs on him three times, but he refused to turn his back on us. That's a summation of grace. We can continue to act like we'll get it together. We can continue to act like, "No, I have what it takes. If I just maybe push a little bit more, if I'm a little bit more intentional about maybe I need a planner. Maybe I need an app on my phone that tells me what to do, when to do it, how to say it." The truth, spiritually engaged, and by that, I mean prayer. Jesus is talking about prayer. If we are not praying, if we are not going to God, if we are not submitting to God, we're going to fall asleep. So I just want to encourage us all this morning. I want to encourage us all this morning, make the time to pray. I know it's such a simple thing. Okay, I'll pray. But it's a much bigger consequence. It's a much, much bigger consequence to fall asleep spiritually. So I'm going to pray right now, and then the band will come up and we will continue to worship God because he is that awesome. God, Lord, I thank you so much for Father blessing me with this experience, this moment to be up here, God. Lord, I pray, Father, I pray that you wake us up. Lord, I pray that you give us the strength, God, the supernatural strength we need to fight this battle between our Peter and our Simon. God, there's a conflict there, and we need your help, God. We need your grace. We need your strength. Lord, wake us up. God, give us energy. Give us zeal. Give us that zeal that Peter has to always be there with you. But then the strength to stand firm. God, I pray protection over the temptations, God. I pray protection as we are tempted with our old self, with our old habits, with our old way of doing things, God. I pray that you would give boldness to the new self that is in our heart, God, to just stand firm. But Lord, that we would just come before you, God, that we would just pray, submit, and surrender to you, Lord. God, I thank you. Lord, you are so good to us, even though we are so, so undeserving. Your grace is still so good, so perfect. Lord, thank you. So Father, we thank you, God. We love you. Lord, we praise you. I pray this in Jesus' name.
Thanks, Dylan.
Yeah.
And I just got to say, I know you're not my son, but I'm proud of you. One of the things that we want you to do is what Dylan just said. We need to pray. Right now. I want to help you to do that a little bit. The tear off in the worship bulletin. Sometimes it helps for us to stop and think about, what is it I need to pray about? What's on your heart? What are you carrying? What do you need to talk to Jesus about? Maybe it's the temptation to give in to the old self and the old battle. By the way, Dylan, I couldn't help but thinking, in the next few moments after Jesus came back that third time and says, okay, enough. My accuser's coming. I don't think it was hard for them to pray for the next several hours, because all of a sudden the stress was real for them that he had been feeling. Sometimes maybe we have to face our lives more honestly in order to really pray. Would you use that tear off and maybe focus your thoughts with God right now? Put your prayer on the tear off if you would. And even if, and again, I give you this permission, if you don't want to share your prayer requests with other people, okay. But I want to invite you to take the next few minutes to talk to Jesus. I'm going to ask that nobody leave the room. Stop. We're not even doing the offering yet, guys. I want you to all to stop and talk to Jesus. This may be one of those moments that if you're comfortable or maybe uncomfortable, you want to get on your knees. Then do that. But take the next few minutes to talk to Jesus. And just in case you're waiting for Pastor Bill to pray, I'm going to pray by myself. You pray. Jesus, there's many times that we don't realize that we're in a spiritual conflict. We're in a spiritual battle. Sometimes we just think it's just exhaustion. It's just flesh and blood. It's just the stuff of life. And yet it is supernatural in its nature. And the biggest battle is trying to keep us from your throne room. Keep us from coming into your presence with honesty and openness, integrity, transparency. There's a battle that's trying to keep us from opening up our hearts completely to you and even sharing our temptations, our sins with you. And we fall back into the old self. Help us, Jesus. Help us to trust you. Help us to turn to you. Lord, may we feel the tension of that battle even more so that we don't give in to falling asleep. I pray, God, your blessing, your power, your anointing on each person here as we fight the battle. And I pray for anyone who doesn't know that you want to fight that battle with them and for them, that today would be the day they say yes and submit completely to you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.